Good morning, Mount Bethel Free Will Baptist Church. And any of you that might be joining us today for our sunrise service, Easter 2020, whether that you're here with us in person, whether you're listening in over the internet, Facebook page, websites, or whatever, we intend to come out this morning and worship Jesus Christ in spirit and truth. We know that America and all of the world is going to go in a terrible, terrible time right now with the COVID-19 virus. I saw yesterday where 2,000 Americans died, 1,700 the day before. It's heartbreaking. And even with that number, my heart goes out because I'm sure there are people dying that don't know Jesus Christ and the free pardon of sin. So it is my prayer, if this preacher, this pastor's prayer, that someone can get to these. Lord, we pray on this resurrection day that the gospel of Jesus Christ is not bound, but his light shines into the world, into the darkness, from out of that tomb, into the hearts of every man, woman, and child. We ask the Lord to help us today as our church is trying to meet, some in parking lots, others in other fashions. Whether or not it's over the internet or in person, Jesus Christ is Lord. We do pray for our Filipino friends, the loss of their great leader, Emmanuel Quezon, the director of IBMA. I've spoken to several IBMA pastors this week. They're heartbroken. If I could say anything, I would say he is to them what Billy Graham was to America. More than 30 years ago, he founded their ministry. And I just pray for consolation, condolences, peace and love, comfort for the Quezon family today. I want to read this poem to you before we move into the musical part of the service. Please pray for us today that Jesus will be glorified. We're about to learn in America for the first time as a generation that Easter is not about a new dress, a fancy hat, coordinating outfits, big hair, floral prints, eggs, decorative crosses, a well-worded sermon, a hyped-up music program, selfies, friends, chocolate, new toys, a trip to the mall, baskets of candy, bunnies, nor family portraits. It's not about inspiring dramas, packed churches, breaking records of attendance, guest retention, fancy lights, children's programs, or family dinner. It's not about all of those things. What we're about to learn this year about Easter, Resurrection Sunday, is about these things: an empty tomb, life over death, fulfilled promises, answered prayers, victory over death, triumph over hell, crushing the grip of the grave, and hope for tomorrow. None of which require a single solitary thing from the first list. This year, Easter will be quiet, intimate communion with Jesus Christ, and that's okay. May it change the way we look at Easter. May it change the way that we look at worship. May it change the way we live our lives forever and ever. Let us pray. Lord, I ask that you bless the singers to come on this resurrection morn, this sunrise service, this Lord's Day, as we come together. Lord, we ask that you would speak to the hearts of those that are not saved, those that might know you and the free pardon of sin. And let we, the believers, look into our lives and draw more clearly, more dearly, and near unto thee. Forgive us where we fail. Strengthen us for the journey before us. Give us your peace, your comfort, and your love. And we'll just give you the praise for it all. It's in Christ's name I ask these things. With thanksgiving, amen and amen.
One day in heaven was filled with his praises. One day when sin was black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin. Thank you.
To see my mother.
Jesus Christ, our Lord. We thank the good Lord for the sweet singing and the presence of God that we have this morning. We thank Him for His presence, His guidance, and we know, even though here and all around the world, as we're going through this COVID virus and the troubles that it brings, that You are still God and You are in control. We'd like to finish a thought from Wednesday night's message when we were talking about Saul being the first king of Israel and the Jews. And also Jesus Christ, as they brought Him in on Palm Sunday in that holy week of the Passover and the festival, how that they looked at Him, if you would, as the last king of the Jews and of Israel. But He let them know for sure His kingdom was not of this world. But He told them, as we said to you on Wednesday night, in Matthew 26:31, all ye shall be offended because of me for this night. I read that verse for this reason. On resurrection morning, they had scattered and gone about their own places. They were hiding in rooms, in caves, maybe in clefts of rocks. In other words, they were afraid and away from those that were persecuting and bringing about the death of our Savior. For it is written, he says, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock shall be scattered abroad. But then he said something I want to bring to your attention. Glorious, glorious this morning, but after I am risen again, I will go before you into Galilee. So Jesus said, even though I will perish, even though I will give up my life this day, I will rise again. So it is so important that we understand that this morning. At different times in the history of Israel, through those kings that they demanded to have to be like the other nations, we see that even with Saul at the Battle of Gilgal, how the battle went against them, and how that the men of Israel hid in caves, in clefts of the rocks, in their strongholds, and their hiding places. Not so much different than what Gideon's men did. Praise God, as before he was their leader, how that the Amalekites had come against them and the people of Midian, and how that the men were trembling and hiding in caves and dens and strongholds. Not so much unlike what's taking place today here in Jerusalem on this resurrection day. Matthew chapter 28, verse number 1. And what's happened here, he's been crucified. He's been placed in the tomb. The watch has been set. And Jesus has died. And the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that you seek Jesus, which was crucified. And here is a victory that we have this morning. He's not here, for he is risen as he said. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There ye shall see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, all hail. They came and held him by his feet, and they worshipped him. Then said Jesus unto them, be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go to Galilee, and there shall they see me. Oh, I praise God for the reading of his word this morning. Jesus is risen. Jesus is risen this morning. I want you to realize something. He is as alive today as he's ever been to those that accept him as Jesus Christ the Lord. I want you to realize, in tying back to what we said about Saul, Saul was the first king. Saul was the king that the Israelites, the Jews of that day, if you would, required a man to lead them and not to follow God, as had been the course through the life of Samuel and the previous judges. We told you the other night how that King Saul was a taker. He would take their children. He would take their men. He would take their women. He would take their maidservants. He would take their grain. He would take all things unto himself, up to a tenth and more. And this is what I want you to hear. In dying, as defeat came upon him, Saul took his own life. He took his own life. The disparity and the difference with Jesus Christ is that Jesus gave his life. He gave his life that we might have eternal life. He did. Enough was even said about Saul that in his dying day, before he died, as he met David, and David came to him with a spear and could have killed him, that Saul said three things. He said, I have erred. I have committed transgressions. I have played the fool. So it's such a sad ending to the first king of Israel and the Jews. But with Jesus Christ, what appeared to be a sad ending brings victory and glory for you and I. I want you to realize that Jesus Christ today is risen. I want you to understand today that Jesus Christ is the light unto this world. I want you to understand today that those that will believe that Jesus is, He is the one. He is the only. And He is the way, the truth, and the life that leads to Jesus Christ and leads us to the Father. You see, we look back at another king today. We look back at King David. And I do this to challenge you, the faithful believers. I want to look back at King David here just in a moment. I want us to realize something, that even as we're seeing here today, I want you to realize something as we read in our opening poem, that it's not about the things that we've always claimed to be, but this year, let us truly gather for the feast, if you would, of Easter and getting together. I want you to know something today, that in a short period of time, that God has revealed to us, not movie stars are our heroes, not reality stars are our heroes, not musicians, not sports heroes, the NBA, the Major League ball players, the NFL, rap and musicians, these are not. But it's our doctors, it's our nurses, it's the truck drivers, it's the farmers, it's the construction workers. It's the box store employees. It's the men and women of God. It's the pastors and those that will preach the Word of God even today. I want you to realize something. Jesus Christ is Lord and there's none like Him. Jesus Christ is our Savior. I want you to know something today. There are four great challenges to meet the church today. There are many, but I will touch on four. And then we'll look at David and 2 Samuel. We are about lifting up individuals and not Christ. We are looking at lifting up people and organizations and movements of people and not Christ. The true church of God has been pushed into the closet. We're not able today in the schoolhouse and in the courthouse, maybe even in the White House, in the town square, wherever, the village square, we have been pushed into the closet. Not only that, there's a new standard for morality. I'm telling you, it's His way or no way. Let me tell you, we can't do this alone. And the fourth thought I'll give you today is together the church wins when we honor Jesus Christ. No other way. That will apply in the United States, in London, England, in the Philippines, or anywhere else that we would go in this world. We're fighting the same battles. I want you to realize something. The Bible says in Psalms 119, 105, Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I want you to realize that in this tomb this morning, in this grave this morning, there was a light, and Jesus is that light. Isaiah 60 says in verse number 1, Arise and shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. I want you to realize, Jesus spake again to them, saying, I am the light of this world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Amen. In Psalms 27, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? In John chapter 1, verse 15, I want you to realize something. And the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. He came into His own, and His own did not accept Him. But those that would believe in Him, He gave them power. Power to be the children of God. Matthew chapter 5, I'll look back at a passage here. First in Matthew chapter 4. Verse 12 says, when Jesus had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which up against the sea coast in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying that the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people which sat in darkness, the Bible says, saw a great light. I want you to know today, church, we are a light unto the world. They saw a great light. This light was Jesus. Unto them which sat in the region and the shadow of death, light is sprung up. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. In chapter 5, verse 13, Jesus said to these, and these words that he spoke to them are words that I want to speak to you today. And though there's a darkness all over the world called the coronavirus, and though there's sin, and though there's battle, and though there's great obstacles, it is a great opportunity today to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Chapter 5, verse 13. Young preachers, don't give up. Pastors' wives, don't give up. Sunday school teachers, don't give up. Gospel musicians, don't give up. We have an opportunity like has never existed. Jesus, through the Spirit of God, is victorious today over death, hell, and the grave. And he is victorious. And for that reason, we can be victorious through this dark hour. Matthew 5:13, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is therefore good for nothing but to cast out, to be trodden under the foot of men. But Jesus said unto them, now realize he's just called them. He's just called them unto him. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And he giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Glory to God. Back in chapter 4, Jesus began to preach. He was walking in Galilee. He saw Simon and Peter. He saw Andrew, his brother, casting a net in the sea, for they were fishermen. And he saith unto them, follow me, I will make you fishers of men. And straightway they left their nets and followed him. I want you to realize something this morning. There's some things we need to leave behind. There's some things we need to take up. We need to take up our cross and follow him. We must become servants unto him. Even Jesus came not to be served, but to serve. Amen. And then we need to be obedient and finish the job. He said unto them, follow me, I will make you fishers of men. Going on, he saw two brethren, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in a ship with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. He called them, and immediately they left the ship and their father and followed him. He told us we might have to give up many things in this world. These men gave up their livelihood. They gave up their nets. They gave up their ship. And they followed Jesus. Jesus, a light into the world. I want you to understand something today. Jesus, a light into the world. Wherefore, my beloved, as you've always obeyed, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God that worketh in you to will and to do all his good pleasure. Folks, I want you to realize something. We are serving in the midst of a crooked and a perverse nation. But he says to us, among whom ye shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life, that we may rejoice in the day of Christ, that we have not run in vain the race that we run, that we know for sure that Jesus Christ is Lord and there's none like him. I want us to realize something today. As we are standing, that we are still waiting for the victory to go home one day. I want you to realize something. As Jesus called these in 2 Samuel chapter 21. David is at the near end of his life. David is nearing the end of his life. His life has been one of which the sword had never left because of his sin. Once again, the difference in the King of the Jews, Jesus, and King David. There was no king who was perfect like our Savior. But even in the end, I want you to realize what they noticed. These men, David had about 400 men that served with him through all persecutions, through all darkness, through all battles of everything. Listen what it says, 2 Samuel 21:15. Moreover, the Philistines had yet war again with Israel. Now David, even being elderly, he went down and his servants with him and fought against the Philistines, and David waxed faint. And Ishbibab, which was one of the sons of the giants, and the weight of his spear weighed 300 shekels of brass in weight, and being girded with a new sword, thought to have slain David. And Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, succored him and smote the Philistine and killed him. And listen to this. Then the men of David swear unto him, saying, thou shalt go no more out with us to battle, that thou quench not the light of Israel. David, of which it was said, out of that throne would come the King, Jesus. Jesus, who is that one who first descended and ascended back to heaven. It came to pass that there was again a battle, the Philistines at Gob, and Shibekai, the Hushamite, slew Saph, which was of the son of a giant. Again another battle at Gob with the Philistines. Eliam, the son of Jerelgam, the Bethlehemite, slew the brother of Goliath the Gittite. The staff of whose spear was like a weaver's beam. Verse number 20, there was yet another battle in Gath. And there was a man of great stature that had on every hand 6 fingers, on every foot 6 toes, 24 in total. And he was born to the giants. And when he defied Israel, Jonathan, the son of Shimei, the brother of David, slew him. These four were born of the giant Gath and fell by the hand of David and by the hand of his servants. How do we parallel these today? There are giants in the world. The giants of uneasiness. The giants of fear. The giants, if you would, the challenges that we must meet here. We already named these. Individuals are being glorified and not Christ. We've never seen it so in all generations till now. The gospel is being pushed into the closet, if you would. It's not proper today to name Jesus Christ out into the public world. Standards of morality have changed in such as even Isaiah chapter 5, they would call evil good and good evil. The Bible even said there that for this reason and this cause that hell hath enlarged itself. Church, I want you to realize together we win. Together we stand together. On this morning, as the ladies went down and they went down to the tomb to further prepare the body for permanent burial with their spices and the garments and different things, I want you to realize something. Jesus Christ is a light unto this world. I want you to realize something, that the light covered him like a garment and stretched out, if you would, the heaven's curtain. I want you to realize they didn't understand, but they had a hope. Some were in hiding, and even as we saw at the cross before Christ died, that some were so fearful even to come out and be seen with him, even in that condition. Jeremiah says something that I want to finish with today. I want you to realize something. In the book of Lamentations, before the southern part, if you would, Judah would go into captivity, that Jeremiah had such a prophecy to preach. But no one would hear. No one would listen. No one would come and stand in the pot. But Jeremiah said, thy word is a fire in my bones. And it was so compressed within him that he couldn't take it. He couldn't stand it. But glory to God. Glory to God. In Jeremiah chapter 20, verse number 9, he simply said, then said I, someone had to take a stand. Young preachers, old pastors, song leaders, Bible members, studiers, teachers, whatever, we need to take a stand today. I will not make mention of him nor speak any more in his name. And this is what he said. But his word was in my heart, as a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I was weary with forbearing, and I could not stay. I want to tell you another version says, sometimes I would tell myself, as I saw no one standing, glory to God, in the book of Ezekiel, he said, I saw if it would be a gap in the hedge. He said, there was no man to stand there with me. Church, today, it's time that we stood for Christ. It's time that we got out of our seats. We got out of our hiding places. We got out of our dark places. And we came to the light of Jesus Christ. We have an opportunity. We have an obligation as children of Jesus to preach the good news. When I say I will forget the Lord and no longer speak in His name, then your message is like a fire burning deep within me. I try my best to hold it in, but can no longer keep it back. Oh, let it be said of this preacher and pastors in our area, and to the Filipino pastors maybe listening today, and people all over America. Oh, it's time that we let that fire that's burning, let it come out in our words. Let it come out in our actions. Let it come out in our prayers. Let it come out, but glory to God, let it come out. Amen. David's men had watched him those years. And as the end of his life was coming, they saw that in his physical strength, he was not who he once was. But even they recognized that this man, a man after the very heart of God, was still willing to fight, was still willing to go into battle. I believe he remembered that time when the Bible speaks of the sin of Bathsheba, that it was a time when kings went to battle, that David was not in battle, that his men's lives were endangered. Oh, but the Bible says because of David's sin, the sword would not leave his family and his life. And it did not. But I can tell you this, I believe that David, even to this time, he would stand up and go at the time of battle to make the stand. Church, if there ever was a time today for battles, it's now. But I'm here to tell you today, don't be concerned with the curse on America and the world, but the hope of America today is that the tomb is empty, that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. Talk about hiding. Acts chapter 1, Jesus has ascended to heaven. And there's that upper room where there's about 120 people. And they gathered not knowing what's going to take place and what's going to happen. But let me tell you something, what's going to happen. There's something going to happen. That same fire that was within Jeremiah. That same fire that Jeremiah and David would share. I want to tell you what comes about. There's a time called Pentecost. Amen. There's a Holy Ghost fire coming from heaven, and it's going to light on whosoever will accept the goodness of God. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like a mighty rushing wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. In America, in the Philippines, when our leaders go by the wayside, somebody's got to take the mantle. Somebody's got to step up. In this day, when people are dying by the thousands each day, in America of all places, somebody's got to take the gospel. It says they saw tongues like flames of fire that separated and came to rest on them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. I want to tell you, there was a great revival took place. Peter got up and preached the gospel, and 3,000 were saved at one time. Folks, I want to tell you this morning, in closing, the tomb is empty. His garment was there as he left it. I want to tell you something. The napkin was folded. Much in the way that when we get up at the dinner table, if we're at home or in a restaurant, maybe we go to the kitchen or to the restroom or something, or whatever during the meal. If we leave it permanently, we just throw our rag down. But if we're coming back, we fold our napkin. Church, I want you to realize the joy and the victory we have today is the tomb is empty. Not only is the tomb empty, but Jesus is coming back. Over in chapter 4 of Acts, I want to share this with you again. Because I want to tell you this morning, young preachers, old pastors, whatever it may be, whatever time in the walk of your life might be, that this is the greatest time in the world to ever be alive. God God has got the attention not only of America, but the Philippines, Cambodia, Thailand, and all over this world. Bibles are selling faster than ever. Googling on the internet, looking up the name Jesus has never been looked up so often. Lifeway is up 143%. Another Goodwill Bible is up 80%. They can't print them quick enough. People are looking. People are hoping. People are searching. Let me tell you something. When the enemy comes against us and it seems to be so great, let me tell you something. Oh, glory to God. The Bible said the multitude of them that were gathered at the first revival at Pentecost, they were believed, they had one heart and one soul. Neither of them had aught the things which he possessed with his own, but they had all things common. And with great power, I want to tell you something, he didn't give us the measure of a little power. The Bible said with great power he gave the apostles witnesses the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them. In closing this morning, yes, if you've made your way out for a sunrise service or a Sunday service at all, this is what I tell you. Great power and great grace are needed today. But I want to tell you the fullness of Jesus Christ is still as it was. Young preachers, I keep saying this, pastors and young preachers, lay people, Sunday school teachers, this morning is the first day of the rest of our life. Let us glorify God. Let us let our light so shine before men that they see our Father in heaven and glorify Him. Our heroes, they're not the ones that we thought they were. They're you and me. They're the common man that's born again of Jesus Christ. Whether you live here in England, in Africa, the Philippines, or wherever you may be today, whether or not our great man Billy Graham left a couple of years ago, whether in the Philippines Dr. Quezon has left, he left a great foundation of believers. Even as David would go, his men were there. Even as Jesus Christ would go. Let me finish with this. I believe the one that loved him, John, was with him there around the cross that day. The rest were in hiding, had gone away. But let me tell you what happened. Each one of those men were martyred and crucified themselves in one fashion or another because they finally believed that Jesus Christ is risen. He is the Lord. He is the Son of God. There's none like Him. He's coming again. And each of them perished and died believing unto the Son of God, Jesus Christ the Lord. The way, the truth, and the life on this Easter Sunday, 2020, Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray. God, I ask if there's anyone hearing this morning that knows you not in the very pardon of sin, let them accept this gift where this great grace and great power comes through the Holy Ghost. Let the Spirit of God rest upon us. Let us be renewed, power from on high. Lead us and guide us and direct us. And for those that claim salvation, let us stir up the fire that's within us. Let us, as Paul told Timothy, to stir up that gift that's within them. It's not a spirit of fear, but it's a spirit of power. It's a spirit of love and a spirit of a sound mind. Amen. To glorifying God. Let us with our words be salt that can be salted and light that can be seen to the glory of Jesus Christ this day. My prayer and my blessing upon you today would be to know Jesus Christ in the free pardon of sin. Help us, O Lord, I pray, in the coming days. Bless America and the nations of this world. Let us know that the battle's not over, but the battle's not ours, it's His. And Jesus Christ is victorious today over death, hell, and the grave. And just as sure as they saw Him ascend into heaven, the angels told them that day He'll return in like manner. Let us be ready to stand in His presence, to bow in His presence, to worship and honor Him. For it's in the precious name of Jesus Christ today that we do bring this message, that we pray, and we give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you is our prayer.
transgression, that he paid the price a long, long time ago. He gave his life for me on a hill called Calvary. But there's something else I want to know. Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Can he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Every time I fail.